Hello friends, in this video I'm going to talk about 8 rules of thumb used in personal finance. If you want to get me started, please type BIO, that is bring it on, in the comment box. Okay, let us get started with the first rule of thumb. The first rule of thumb is called the rule of 72. This rule is very, very useful, especially if you want to know how much time it takes to double your money. If you walk into a bank and ask the banker, I have got 1 lakh rupees and I want to invest it. Can you tell me how much time will it take to double my money? And you will see the banker, without even using the calculator, will tell you at present rate of interest is 6%. So if you invest your money today, it will take approximately 12 years to get your money doubled. It's very simple. Time to double your money is nothing but 72 divided by 6, that is 12 years. Now, why is it called the rule of 72? It is called rule of 72 simply because, you see, the numerator 72 is constant. So for example, if the rate of interest is 12%, then time required to double your money will be 6 years. How do I get that 6 years? 72 divided by 12. For this, please remember, rule of 72 gives you approximate time required to double your money. It doesn't give you the exact answer. So to get the exact answer, you can use this calculator. The link for accessing this calculator I have provided in the description box, so you can refer to this calculator. Say for example, you have 1 rupee and you want to double it. So your initial amount is 1, you want to double it to 2, this rate is 6%. Then how much time will it require to get your money doubled? It is 11.9 years exact. This is the exact calculation, but according to rule of 72, it should be 12 years. So you can see rule of 72 gives you very close approximation to the correct answer, right? Now you can play with this calculator. Suppose if I make this interest rate 12%, so automatically you can see according to rule of 72, it says it will take 6 years. And if you go for the exact calculation, the exact answer is 6.12 years, right? You get very close approximation to the correct answer. So you can just play around. If you take the interest rate as 8%, then time required to double your money is 9 years and so on. So this is how you can use rule of 72 to find out how much time do you need to double your money at a given interest rate. Now let us move to the next rule. That is rule number 2. Rule number 2 is called rule of 114 or rule of 114. So what does this rule talk about? It tells us the number of years that you need, the number of years that you require to triple your money at a given interest rate. Say, for example, if the interest rate is 6%, then it will approximately take 19 years to triple your money. Now, how do I get this 19 years? It's very simple. It is 114 divided by 6. That is 19 years, right? I have given the link for the calculator. You can just cross-check. Suppose your initial amount is 1 rupee and your target is 3 rupees. That means you want to triple your money. Right, interest rate is 6%, then how much time do you need to triple your money? It is 18.85 years. This is exact calculation. And as per rule of 114, the time that you need to triple your money is 19 years. And as you can see, it gives you a very close approximation to the correct answer or exact answer, right? So you can just play with this calculator. If the rate of interest is 12%, then time required as per the exact calculation is 9.69 years to triple your money. And as per rule of 114, it is 9.5 years. Again, you can see rule of 114 is giving a very close approximation to the exact answers. Now let us move to next rule, that is rule number 3. Now what does this rule number 3 talk about? It basically talks about the time that you need to quadruple your money at a given rate, given interest rate. It basically talks about the time that you need to quadruple your money at a given interest rate. So third rule is nothing but rule of 144 or rule of 144. If the interest rate is 6%, it will approximately take 24 years to make your money grow 4 times, right? It will take 24 years to quadruple your money if the interest rate is 6%. So how do I get this 24 years? It's very simple. Time required is nothing but 144 divided by 6. 144 divided by 6 is 24. So 24 years is the answer, right? So why is it called rule of 144? Because as you can see in the numerator, this 144 is constant. Instead of 6%, if the interest rate is 10%, then how much time do you need to quadruple your money? The answer is 14.4 years. How do I get this 14.4 years? It's nothing but 144 divided by 10. So here also I have given the link for accessing the calculator. You can just cross-check these calculations using calculator. Calculator will give you the exact answer and also the answer as per the rule that we are talking about, right? In this case, we are talking about rule of 144. Suppose you have an initial amount of rupee 1. So your target is to make it 4x. That is, you want to grow it 4 times. So your target should be 4 rupees, right? If the interest rate is 6%, then time required to actually make your money grow 4x is 23.79 years. And you can see as per rule of 144, it is 24 years. And as you have seen earlier, you know, these rules actually give you very close approximation to the correct answer or the exact answer, right? So as per rule of 144, the answer is 24 years. And if you go for the exact calculation, the answer is 23.79 years, right? As usual, you can just play with this interest rate. If you make it 12%, you can see the answer changes. Approximately 12 years is the answer, right? If you make it 10%, then 14.4 years is the answer, approximate answer, and exact answer is 14.55%. So I think you have got this, right? So let us go back to the other rule that we plan to talk about, right? So next rule, that is rule number 4, tells you the number of years needed to reduce your money to half of its current value at a given inflation rate. Now, what is inflation rate? Inflation rate is nothing but the rate at which the price levels are increasing, right? Now, if you just give 10,000 rupees in your locker, you should not think that the value of this 10,000 rupees will remain same with time. After 5 years, the purchasing power of this 10,000 rupees will not be same as the purchasing power that this 10,000 rupees has today, right? Why? Because price levels are going up. That is what technically called the inflation, right? Because of inflation, if you just simply keep your money in locker or under your pillow, it's not going to grow. Rather, it is going to degrow, right? It is going to reduce the value of your money, right? Say, for example, if the inflation rate is 7%, approximately in 10 years, value of rupees 2 will reduce to rupee 1. That means it will become half, right? So how do I calculate that time? the time is equal to 70 divided by 7, because 7% is the inflation rate. 70 will be constant. That's why it is called rule of 70. If the inflation rate is 10%, then in 7 years, the value of your money will reduce by 50%, right? So you can see how dangerous the inflation rate is, right? You know, it's a silent killer, as we say, right? Because we really do not understand this, or most of the times it remains unnoticed that inflation is silently eating away the purchasing power of money that you have. So if you keep your money idle, right, it is definitely not going to grow. On the contrary, it is going to degrow, right, because of the inflation. So here also I have given a link for accessing the calculator. As you can see, I am talking about rule of 70. Your initial amount in this case is 2 rupees. So target is half, because you want to find out how much time does it take to eat away the purchasing power or the value of your current fund by 50%, right? So how much time does it take to, you know, eat away 50% of the current valuation because of the inflation, right? Say inflation rate is 7%, then rule of 70 talks about or gives you an answer of 10 years, right? The exact answer is 10.24 years. Again, as you can see, it gives you a close approximation to the exact answer. You can just play around with this calculator. If the inflation rate is 6%, then the answer changes. Approximately 11.67 years is the time required to actually, you know, make your money half, right? If it is inflation rate is 10%, then it requires approximately 7 years to actually eat away your money, you know, to eat away 50% of your current valuation, right? So this is how you can apply this rule of 70 to find out how fast or how much time will inflation take to eat away 50% of your wealth if you do not do anything with your wealth, right? If you do not invest your wealth somewhere else, if you keep it idle, then inflation will eat away the value of your wealth. Now we talk about the next rule, that is 100 minus your age rule. This is again a very, very useful rule. Often we have this confusion. When we have money, we are in some kind of, you know, confusion. How much of that money should be invested in risky asset and how much of the money should be invested in risk-free asset? Now you might ask me, why would I invest in risky asset? Reason is very simple. If you invest in risky asset, return potential is also high, right? So if you take no risk, return potential will be very, very less, right? If you take more risk, return potential will be more. Naturally, the question comes, how much of your fund should be allocated towards risky asset and how much should be allocated towards risk-free asset? This rule gives you that answer, 100 minus your age rule. Suppose your age is 40 years, then 60% of your money should be invested in risky asset and 40% of your money should be invested in risk-free assets. By risky asset, I means you can put your money in stocks, right? You can invest in stocks. You can invest in mutual funds, right? These are all examples of investing in risky asset. If you do not want to take any risk, then you have to invest in risk-free asset, fixed income securities. Say, for example, you can invest in government bonds. You can make FDs in banks. So these are all examples of risk-free asset. Now, as you can see, as you grow older, you should put lesser and lesser amount in risky asset, right? When you have just started earning money, you can take more risk. So someone who is of, say, 25 years of age, someone who is just 25 years old, would put 75% of his fund into risky asset and 25% into risk-free asset, right? So this rule of thumb is again very, very useful because it gives you a very simple solution to the problem of your asset allocation, right? How much of your asset should be invested in risky assets and how much should be invested in risk-free asset. Hope this is useful. So let us move to the next rule. That is called 50-30-20 rule. This is again a very, very useful rule. We often have this question in mind, how should I allocate my monthly income? Most of us do not really have any plan or any system. We do not spend systematically, right? Or we do not save or we do not invest systematically because we do not have any system in place when it comes to spending and when it comes to saving and investing, right? So if you are one of those persons, then this rule might be of help to you. So what does this rule say? It says you have to allocate your monthly income in this, you know, ratio of 50:30:20. Now, more specifically, 50% of your monthly income should be spent on your needs, like your groceries, your rent, your utility bills, your EMIs, right? These are all periodic expenses, right, that you need to make, right? 30% of your monthly income should be in wants, right? By wants, I mean, you know, you can go for a movie, you can go for a vacation, right? For entertainment purpose, you can spend, right? I think you all understand the difference between needs and wants, right? Needs are, you know, essential, right? It means you cannot do away with these spending, right? You have to. Wants, if you have money, then you can, because everybody cannot afford a movie in Inox, right? Everybody cannot afford a vacation in Europe, right? So it depends, and it's not the, you know, first level requirement, right? So if you have enough money, then you can go for it. So that's the basic difference between needs and wants, right? We want to go for a vacation abroad, right? But we need to pay our EMIs. That's the difference, correct? The remaining 20% should be saved, right? By saving, I mean you need to invest, right? You can invest in, depending upon your age, you can decide how much of your money, how much of your saved money should be invested in risky asset and how much of your saved money should be invested in risk-free asset, right? Rule number 7. This rule talks about how much of your monthly income you should spend at the max on your EMIs. Why this rule is very, very important is most of us live on EMIs, right? We have EMIs to be paid for home loans, for car loans, for personal loans, for credit cards and whatnot. So you have to have a limit beyond which your EMIs should never go. And how do you decide that limit? It is the 40% rule that will tell you the limit. It's very simple. Your EMIs, all EMIs put together, it should never exceed 40% of your monthly income. So if you earn 50,000 a month, total EMIs all put together should not be more than 20,000. Ideally, it should be below 20,000. So how do I get this 20,000? That is 40% of 50,000. That is why this is called 40% EMI rule, right? So you have to ensure that under no circumstances, your EMI amount exceeds 40% of your monthly income. Let us move to the next rule. The next rule is rule number 8. Last but definitely not the least. So what does this rule talk about? This rule is actually called 20 times SA rule. SA means sum assured. So this rule basically gives you an answer to the question, how much amount you should have as sum assured in your term insurance. We all have, or at least we all should have a term insurance, right? And when we take a term insurance, this is a common question that all of us have. What is the question? How much should be the sum assured? This rule gives you answer for that particular question. It should be 20 times of your annual income. That means sum assured should be 20 times of your annual income. If you earn 5 lakh rupees per annum, that is, if your annual income is 5 lakh rupees, then you have to have a term insurance where sum assured is rupees 1 crore. The idea is very simple. You should leave enough money for those who are dependent on you. Nobody wants, you know, untoward things to happen, but unfortunately these things do happen, right? If things go wrong, you should leave enough money for those who are dependent on you. Now, how do you decide how much is enough? To answer that, this rule comes out to be very handy. So that's it about these rules of thumb for personal finance. If you find this video useful, if you find the information given in this video useful, right, helpful, then do share, comment, and, you know, do subscribe to my channel, and also hit the bell icon so that every time I upload a new video, you get notified. Thank you. Thank you for watching this video. Thank you for your time.